Well, I'd like to welcome you tonight. Hopefully, you don't have to use your umbrellas. But we do have some upcoming lectures on July 16th, Blood in West Virginia, Brumfield versus McCoy by Brandon Kirk. And then on July 23rd at 6 o'clock, it's going to be one of our block speaker series, African American Life with Personal Perspective by Hubert S. Rabbit Jones. Those are coming up in the month of July. Now, for the month of August, we have some, they're actually posted onto our website now. All you have to do is just go to wdculture.org/history, and you click on the lectures, and it will take you right to the page where it shows all the upcoming lectures, even beyond August.
Are you still going to send out the emails?
If you leave your email with us, we can actually do the email blast, the news blast. That way, anything coming up as far as events and things like that, if you want to just leave your email with us, we can go ahead and get you into our system there. So when anything comes up, even on some of the special things as far as some of the exhibits and things that we put up, we also do news blasts on those also. Tonight, Dr. Paul Rakes will discuss the meanest county in the nation, hip pocket ethics on the early New River coal mining frontier, 1890 to 1910. Any mentions of saloons and gunplay in mining towns usually produces popular images of more nationally famous locales such as Deadwood, South Dakota, made famous by early dime novels and later by Hollywood filmmakers. In reality, the earliest coal operations of West Virginia's Fayette County possess most of the elements common to all the nation's mining frontiers. As with early mining towns in the legendary Wild West, Fayette's early rudimentary coal camps attracted a number of young, transient, often hot-headed males who adhered to a philosophy that required one to stand his ground in confrontations. Contrary to popular images, miners both in the West and in the East who carried pistols usually did so in a hip pocket, and the dramatic increase of violent confrontations in Fayette County often resulted from the guidelines of hip pocket ethics. In fact, the increase of violence associated with the early camps led one Ohio newspaper to refer to Fayette as the meanest county in the nation. A third-generation coal miner, Dr. Rakes, professor at WVU Tech, worked as a coal miner for 20 years before leaving mining to earn his PhD in history at the West Virginia University. His research focuses both on technology and on the labor culture of coal miners in West Virginia. He has produced such professional journal articles as Technology and Transition, The Dilemmas of Early 20th Century Coal Mining, for the Journal of Appalachian Studies, and West Virginia Coal Mine Fatalities, The Subculture of Danger, and a Statistical Overview of the Pre-Enforcement Era, and Casualties on the Home Front, World War II Era Coal Disasters in West Virginia, for West Virginia History. Book chapters include The Combat Scenario, Early Coal Mining and the Culture of Danger in Culture, Class, and Politics, and Modern Appalachia, 2009. And A Hard-Bitten Lot, Non-Strike Violence in the Early Southern West Virginia Coal Fields and Blood in the Hills, A History of Violence in Appalachia, in 2011. Dr. Rakes has served as a consultant for several televised video productions focusing on coal mining history and is regularly called upon by news agencies to provide insight into current mining developments. Additionally, he contributed a short memoir regarding growing up in the coal fields in Anthology of American of Appalachian Writers. Please welcome Dr. Rakes.
Okay, fair enough. Well, if I get too many things in my hands, I can't operate. So let me first apologize for being somewhat tardy tonight. The reason for that is rather simple. I can't see up close, so I had to stop at a drugstore and try to find something that might work because I left my reading glasses in my office. which has to do with getting old, I guess. Also, the reality is I'm always a coal miner, and I always will be. And one of the reasons that I continue to bring this particular slide with me, you're truly over on your right in the very back, is that I've realized the older I've gotten, even though I've been through PhD training, even though I've spent 21 years among academics, my ethical code is still very much that of a coal miner. And in particular, my matriculation was coal mining, plain and simple. And this is a segment of the last group I worked with, and I always want to say to audiences, my admiration, my respect for these particular individuals. I will always hold a bond to them that I will never hold to anyone in academia, which is not downgrading academia, it's simply saying they are different worlds. I wish that I had a photograph of my earliest days in mining with the New River Company, when the miners from the generation before mine, and some of them even a generation before that, taught me the nuances of mining and taught me what it meant to be a miner. Unfortunately, those I do not have, but I always maintain a lot of respect for these folks. Also, last October was supposed to be my last lecture, but when in talking to Randy, here I am again. You reach a point you can only go so many years, right? 20 years at mining and then 21 years at academia. It's time for me to have some fun, but I keep coming back. Also, many of my students are now saying, they used to say, I think you know my father. I think you work with him in the mines. Now they're saying, I think you know my grandfather. I believe you work with him in the mines. And I'm getting out before someone says, I think you knew my great-grandfather. I want to remind you that what we're looking at tonight is primarily the Fayette County coal camps in their very earliest period. Not once the camps mature. That's what most people think of when they think of coal camps. I do. When I think of the first time that I went to a movie theater, it was at the New River Company movie theater, Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis, for heaven's sake, in Scarborough. First time I remember being in a store where you could, to buy goods, was at the company store at Scarborough. But those, that's the mature element. Tonight we're talking about those very first developments of the coal camps. And that's where one sometimes runs into a problem. In history, professional history, we tend to create models. And we need things to fit within that model. And those things that don't quite fit sometimes cause a lot of consternation among historians. And that often can result in problems of looking at what is really quite messy. Life is messy. History is messy. And there are always outliers. There's always things that don't quite fit. And so when most people look at the early coal camps, they're really looking at the situation when the camps have matured somewhat. And that tends to be a little too early to actually establish any real model or fit the model. It's true whether one is looking at the presence of mine guards, whether you're looking at the presence of what's going on underground, and certainly what's going on among the miners themselves. 1906, a rather frustrated prosecuting attorney in West Virginia's Fayette County found that he was unable to win a murder conviction because of an unusual set of circumstances. And that set of circumstances was that one of the coal miners at Peril, which is present-day Summerlee, and mine was just beginning, had killed another man in the new coal camp. And it was really just, it wasn't even a camp yet. It was just a lot of shanties thrown up. But the explosion at Summerlee killed all the witnesses, so they couldn't go to trial, which gives you an idea of how closely these folks, that not only they worked together, they saw each other in the rudimentary camps early on, they drank together, and it led to problems. In this case, it was problems over a female. There are very few women around at first, as you might well imagine, and competition increases there. But at this same term of court in Fayette County in 1906, the increased level of violence was quite apparent. As the coal industry expanded, more and more murder cases came before the county court. And it's not limited to just males. There are often cases of self-defense, which gets difficult to define on occasion. But same term of court in 1906, Emma Hess, a Fayette County woman, shot and killed Leslie Smithen in the coal town of Kilsyth. But it was dismissed because it was considered self-defense. But these identifications, these definitions of what is self-defense becomes problematic over a period of time. But these early coal camps proved to be potentially dangerous places for the more rowdy miners. Now, that's the key element. It is the folks who frequent saloons. It's the folks who are naturally a bit more rowdy that are going to get into these problems in these situations. Usually, not always, but usually. If one looks at the American West, which of course is more famous in legend, it will be the same thing. It's the rowdy individuals that frequent saloons and so forth that get into trouble. In essence, these developing coal camps early on were certainly characterized by those elements that we associate with the American West. The young coal miners who came in, they hailed from a wide variety of geographical backgrounds, just as you have in the American West. They came to these infant operations of Fayette County where many of them frequented the saloons. They drank heavily. They argued over card games and crap games, both quite popular at the time. They became dangerously boisterous at holiday celebrations. They held a strong attraction to firearms. And they made use of the unrestricted availability of cocaine. Folks tend to not think of that, but in the time period, cocaine was quite rampant, and you could buy it from peddlers. And most of these younger individuals who are somewhat hot-headed would take offense rather quickly at any perceived insult. Early interpretations of these early coal camps involved looking at the social and the work-related, involves looking at both the work-related combat as well as the concept of a violent mountaineer. Very early on, folks, scholars are saying, well, it's because of these mountaineers who are naturally violent. Now, most of you will know that that argument has long since passed, but very, very early scholars, such as Harry Cottle, he argued that what came to the coal camps was a class of people that were quick with their fists, quick to use lethal weapons, heavy consumers of alcohol, and Cottle applied that reality to what he called Appalachian society, where shootings and stabbings and fisticuffs were common. The problem with that argument is obvious, I'm sure to most of you, in that Fayette's early coal camps, for example, those people came from a variety of backgrounds, particularly the nation's south. Lots and lots of miners came in early on from Virginia, North Carolina, both white and black, and other areas of the south, but particularly Virginia and North Carolina. In the agricultural areas, such as Fayette, the local population was unable to supply the needed number of miners. Even in this early development of these county cooperations. So by the mid-1880s, and certainly into the 1890s, there's an ever-increasing number of individuals that have skilled trades, for example, blacksmiths and what have you. They see this wage opportunity, and they head for the coal fields, and they come in large numbers. The nation is changing at the time, of course. This is the era when you have the very early development of what will become corporations, They have that industrialization of America. And so here's a place of wage opportunity. As the operations expand along the new river tributaries, this multitude of newcomers to the area include lots of ruffians. And I've gotten behind here. I got ahead of myself a bit, but I would like you to notice this photograph. If you can see this, this is a cattle drive now, or moving cattle through a town. Now, most people see this, they would immediately think of somewhere out in the American West because they see all these cattle. In reality, it's Mount Hope in Fayette County in 1903. I'm thinking I may be off a year or two on that. It's this early period of development when you're still using animals as the principal means of energy and power. This was the best I had that I could transfer in regard to the New River coal fields, or the Fayette County coal fields, I should say. And it's pretty jumbled up here. Very earliest coal fields would be places that aren't shown on here, such as Beechwood. If you want to get gunned down in 1900, go to Beechwood on New River. Guarantee you hang around in a saloon, sooner or later you'll get involved. It probably tops the record. It's a very short-lived coal camp, and it's no wonder they probably killed everybody before they got. And of course, there, very early, Stonecliff, Thurman, quite popular. Red Ash, Rush Run, another violent place in Fayette County. I grew up hearing about Rush Run from my violent grandfathers, and particularly my violent uncles. And they would tell me stories about Rush Run, but it didn't register until recently when I started looking at much of this. And very early ones such as Concho and so forth. If you are familiar with I have to step back till I get too close, I can't see it. If you're familiar with the Glen Jean area, where the National Park Service has its headquarters today for the National Park, or for the New River, nearby were places such as Dairy Hill, which tended to be rather violent places as well. But it's through this area that we're principally looking at this evening. But coming into the region, especially areas such as Sewell, lots of 4th of July celebrations in Sewell, invariably they turn into gunplay. One miner from Virginia, Funston Cox, one of the favorite people I've come across, because if anyone fits our stereotypical image, let's say, of a bad man in the West, this guy fits it. He had already killed someone and been on a chain gang within a short time of arriving. Then he's at Sewell, the 4th of July celebration. He kills the self-designated constable. He gets all. He gets pardoned by the governor. It is a black miner who has killed a white self-appointed constable. Still, he is released. And then he gets in trouble again, is on the chain gang, escapes, and gets away, and they never find him. But there are plenty of people like Funston Cox that show up in Fayette County. There are individuals, of course, who simply are criminal by nature. They get involved in drunken sprees and gun down people, usually unarmed. In the conditions in the various coal camps at the time usually are looked at during era of labor strife. And that's where one runs into a bit of a problem. We have to be careful about developing mistaken generalizations of what's going on in a coal camp when there's serious labor problems and what's going on an everyday basis. Those are two different dynamics. Now, some of that's going to overlap, of course. But many of the early mine guards, for example, are not from agencies. They are miners that have been hurt underground. And so the company gives them a job watching the powder house until they're healed again and they go back underground. Things of that sort. It doesn't take away from what disgusts me as a miner, the formal Baldwin Felts agency coming in later, but keep in mind, it doesn't apply to every situation. Those formalized agencies are not at every mine site. Again, a lot of these folks will accept jobs as guards, which helps them get access to guns, although guns are easily acquired in the time period. You can buy them in the company store. But there's the impact of the hot-headedness of these individuals certainly can be seen in the prison records at the time. The penitentiary warden, which 1904 was Charles Haddox, he lamented this dramatic increase of prisoners coming to Moundsville as a result of violent crime. In 1880, there were only 3 prisoners at Moundsville that came from Fayette County. 3. By 1904, that number had risen to 130. Now, the contemporary reaction to this and the reaction of the governor was, well, that's simply because the population increased. It doesn't fit. The prison warden said, no, wait a minute, man, look at these figures. He quelled the governor's argument when he said, in Fayette County, the ratio is one person convicted, a convicted felon, not misdemeanors, a felon, convicted for every 277 citizens, one in every 277 for Fayette. And he compared that figure to one convict in a total population of 6,500 in neighboring Nicholas County. So obviously something's going on. No, I can't do 2 things at once, I apologize. Continuous miners broke down, I can repair that. But I can't operate this thing, so there you go. and just a group of these miners coming in from a variety of areas that I have, but this is really what I was after. It's obvious that within these coal camps, there is a dramatic increase of violence. 80% in those coal counties, and definitely in Fayette County, 80% of the crimes are violent in nature. And if you have one in 277 convicted in Fayette County, obviously there's a great deal of violence going on. Now, the reality is that Fayette County's legal infrastructure at the time quickly becomes insufficient. They can't deal with this. There's this upsurge of felonies is just more than the system can handle. So the legislature divided Fayette's high court organization into 2 branches, just a criminal court that did nothing but deal with criminal cases, and then a circuit court to consider civil cases. Below this county level, this county judicial branch, I should say, below that branch were the conservators of the peace. This included a popularly elected justice of the peace, and I'm sure many of you here will remember when we had JPs and constables and so forth. There was a justice of the peace and a constable within given magisterial districts. And this unit provided the first step in legal proceedings by conducting a preliminary hearing and setting bail, if applicable, and so forth. Locally elected constables, technically they held police powers throughout the state, but primarily they served as the enforcement officer within a squire's district, a JP's district. But with this staggering growth of operations along Dunloop Creek, White Oak, Arbuckle Creek, it made effective law enforcement just simply impossible. For one thing, transportation to the various coal camps is problematic. The branch lines that are put in are there for coal haulage. So as such, by the time a constable receives word that there is a problem and he travels to a location, a perpetrator has probably made their escape. If there's no official constable available, a justice might appoint a local person as a special constable. And it's the last thing you want to happen to you. Tell the JP, forget it. The reason is rowdy individuals generally held little regard for this type of representative. You say the JP appointed you, we're not going to pay any attention to you. And plenty of them got gunned down. Rowdy miners refused to recognize these individuals usually as peace officers. I'm asked this question rather often, but let me see how I can deal with it. West Virginia prohibited the carrying of firearms. But although the carrying of firearms was prohibited by law, Confrontations involving such weapons, particularly pistols, dominated those violent episodes in Fayette's early coal development. You will find straight razors used. You will find knives in some cases, but it's usually a pistol. There was a challenge of the constitutionality of this law in 1891, but West Virginia's Supreme Court of Appeals upheld the law. They said their argument was that weapons such as pistols represented devices that were habitually carried by bullies, blackguards, and desperados. And so the Second Amendment of the Constitution was not designed to protect them. Well, if there are, think of this from a coal miner standpoint in time, if there are blackguards and bullies out there who are going to carry weapons no matter what, then maybe you better arm yourself. And a lot of people think that way at the time. Shortly before that, the West Virginia Supreme Court of Appeals, they said a person had the right to defend themselves if they believed, had good cause to believe they were in danger. And even if a defendant might be standing isolated and alone, he's by himself, he can't get by with killing someone because there's a simple threat. So the court's constantly contradicting itself, and it's hard to, they're trying to work this all out themselves, to be honest. But there was, what becomes clear in listening to the court, and sometimes, since I'm approaching retirement, I'll say this sort of thing, and sometimes it happens with me as academics. The reality is none of those judges ever stood toe-to-toe with some ruffian in a saloon somewhere. It's one thing to talk about it academically and to try to work all this out and what is legal and what is not. And that's what they're paid to do, sure. But for that average person at a public celebration, or heaven forbid if he frequents a saloon, that's all a lot of talk. The reality is the law in West Virginia was ineffective. It was impossible to report the numerous cases against the individuals for discharging or carrying firearms. In fact, there were complaints in Fayette County that they couldn't carry on church services because there was so much gunfire going on Sunday, people out just firing their weapons. One of the co-operators that I certainly admire was Tams, who established Tams in West Virginia, and he remembered these individuals, while he was in Fayette County in particular, he remembered them as a tough group that enjoyed both drinking and gambling. And in Tam's memoir, he accurately recalled, because I checked on it, he recalled that 8 men were killed in confrontations in Fayette County in one short week in 1904. 8, that would be high for today, even in some of our more vicious areas of the country. And it's during that period of time that an Ohio newspaper refers to Fayette County as the meanest county in the entire nation. I don't know if that's true, but you could possibly defend that idea. But even there are professional gamblers who show up. There are folks in particular who run these faro games and these roulette tables. That leads to problems. But there were lots of friendly exhibitions of a particular weapon's attributes. These miners loved, most of them loved, weapons, particularly pistols. Ivor Johnson's and Colt, the most popular. They trade them, they talk about the attributes of each one, and they oftentimes will go outside to exhibit their skill with a pistol. There are a couple cases, one at Stonecliff, I don't know what map up there now, one at Stonecliff in particular, where they go outside to have a bit of a shooting match, and before the whole thing's over with, the local constable has been elected. He got in on the shooting match, and they sent him to Moundsville because someone was killed in the whole business. They get their drinking, they argue, and that's the sort of thing that happens. There are a lot of similarities to the more famous frontier towns of the American West, and they didn't go unnoticed at the time, even at the time. There were popular dime novels that had already spread the stereotypical view of the Wild West. And that's long before there were any Hollywood films, of course. 1904, one newspaper used the headline, Wild Western Fun at Boomer. I'm sure many of you know where Boomer is at down on the river there in Fayette. What they were describing was one miner was going to force his friend to dance by firing into the floor with his pistol. But of course, he's not a marksman of high repute, so he shoots his friend. So hence it's Wild West fun at Boomer. Fun, it didn't sound like a lot of fun to me, but the same publication seemed pleased to report in 1905 in Fayette County that even though it was payday, even though there had been more gunplay than usual in Fayette County, there had been only a few murders that weekend. Only a few murders. What's a few? There was a strange, in that same time period, there was a strange homicide. It's one of the more interesting cases I came across. A strange homicide that occurred in the Kilsyth coal camp when a couple exuberant miners, quite inebriated at the time, decided to serenade their neighbor. And their neighbor is unamused, and so he threw a bucket of slop on them to get them to shut up, to stop their caterwauling. And these drunken musicians of sorts immediately gunned him down. But even though a Fayette newspaper at the time may not have made the specific connection, coal diggers also shared working world similarities with the more popularized miners out west. If you stop for a moment and think about the really deadly towns out west, they're not cow towns. Deadwood is a mining town. Bodie, California, which may have been the most violent of all of them, was a mining town. And soon you have the same developments. Very early on, you have placer mining. That is replaced by larger companies. And so miners are working for companies. They find themselves in rudimentary coal camps and so forth, and it produces problems. But it is a dangerous world, as many of you know. Although I'd like to know what it's like to work in top that high. I can't recall ever being in a seam that high, but miners are hurt on a regular basis. Now I'm cheating a little bit here. This is actually not from Fayette County, but this is a common scene in the coal camps as well. This individual was not gunned down. He was killed in the mine, of course, but it was the only example of this I could find. This is much farther north. And the whole process of working in the mine is well displayed by this. 1886, one miner for every 148 miners killed. That's in 1 year. The longer you work in the mine, the more chances are you're going to be one of these. You can see it doesn't improve a great deal over this time period. So they work in a rather violent world. When I say it's similar to cow, if you stop and think about cowhands, for example, and I mentioned mining was the more violent towns out west, but a cowboy, they mercilessly drive cattle. That's a world of violence as well. They involve themselves in the cruelty of branding, of dehorning, of castrating animals. These are people that their working world to some degree is violent. And the young men that are attracted to wages available in these early coal enterprises in along the river itself, they fall victim to haulage accidents and so forth, and particularly slate falls. Many of them witness the death of their friends and their fellow workers, the slaughter of mules from runaway trips. There is a study of the violence of frontier mining towns in the American West. And in the situation is similar in that what is found by Roger McGrath, the historian that did the study, is that it was a population of mostly young men that valued such attributes as self-reliance and courage. Self-reliance and courage. When we're talking about this underground. I remember going in the mines, and one of my primary concerns was, how will I react in a dangerous situation? My father and my grandfather said it, whether they had said it directly or not, it was built into my thinking that I had to be brave when times got tough. I had to exhibit courage. Heaven forbid that I am cowardly in a situation. If I do, my dignity as a miner is gone. And in fact, these miners who can expect to be killed or hurt, underground or hopefully not in a saloon, but they tended to embrace guidelines of honor in the workplace. That easily translated to exhibitions of courage and pride, particularly by young hot-headed individuals in the saloons, in the boarding houses. I think I have a boarding house up here. Boarding houses could be dangerous places. You have these individuals thrown together. They're close to one another. They get in arguments that happened in Fayette County. There was an argument over a pair of shoes. One miner killed the other when he shot him in the back as he walked out in the yard for the to have their one-on-one battle. Most folks aren't killed in an exchange of gunfire, same as out west. Most are killed when they're unarmed or shot in the back, things of that sort. Most of these miners appear to have willingly displayed what has been termed as reckless bravado, a willingness to exchange gunfire over a careless remark, an insult to or a challenge to their fighting ability, what can result in gunplay. The variety of court cases and jury decisions in Fayette suggest that the early miners and general population had come to embrace some degree of a legal theory that a person could and should hold their ground. Now, I noticed there's folks in here my age and so forth, and I would imagine that most of you came up with fathers and uncles and so forth that ingrained you with this idea. You have the right to hold your ground, to stand your ground. This was a shift that occurs for the most part in America. Up until mid-19th century and into the late 19th century, the basic theory was your back had to be against the wall. You had to be forced into a position you could not get out of. Then you could react with deadly force. That began to change. And it causes a problem for the West Virginia Supreme Court of Appeals because they're in that transitional period. It changes to, you don't have any duty to retreat. You're minding your own business. You're not bothering anyone. If you're accosted, you can react. To not do so, of course, affected those miners' concept of themselves and courage that we mentioned a moment ago. The governor at the time, William Glasscock, actually cited the older English standard of self-defense. A young miner killed another, a ruffian who had him cornered, had him literally backed against the wall. But those folks living on this industrial frontier, in this turmoil, they came to realize what legal scholars in protected environments failed to grasp. In earlier centuries, you might outrun a spear. So you have a duty to retreat. You're not pinned against the wall. You might outrun a spear, but you're not going to outrun a bullet. And miners, in particular, came to believe in this approach. In fact, in Boomer in 1901, George Dent, an elderly fellow, he actually tried to flee from an altercation with a group of intoxicated miners. They simply gunned him down from a distance, shot him in the back. And nevertheless, identifying actual consistency of coal country juries, and particularly the Fayette County juries, is difficult, if not impossible. In some cases, individuals that had undeniably reacted to a significant threat will be convicted of manslaughter or second-degree murder or sometimes first-degree murder, while others in similar circumstances enjoyed acquittals. And I cannot get a handle on it. I know most of you, if any of you have served on jury duty, particularly murder trials, you know how difficult that can be. But thanks to Deborah Basham, I read a lot of court trial transcripts that went to the West Virginia Supreme Court, State Supreme Court, and I oftentimes cannot, find the whys and the wherefores of why some people in similar cases are convicted of murder and others are not. But they're pouring lots of people into this relatively barren landscape of Fayette County. Many Hungarians began to come in by 1906, 1907, but in Fayette County, well up to 1910, although there will be some areas such as Boomer that has a large Italian constituency, most miners in Fayette County are native born. Now, not meaning native born in West Virginia, but from the South, from Ohio, from Pennsylvania, other areas. The expansion philosophy for these co-operations included quickly providing amenities for coal camp life, but the logistics of construction meant that the earliest workers often had to, come back to just a moment, often had to refer to the common practice of shantying. Now, when most folks think of a coal camp, this is what they think of. It's a pretty nice coal camp. Look, Brian, the one I grew up in Charleston. One of the things that always comes to mind, I remember one of my very earliest times of getting in trouble in the Scarborough coal camp. And it's because I was playing in a big mud hole out in front of the house, out in the lane out there. That's great. That's wonderful to me. But to my parents, they want to move away from those type of situations. And so when people remember coal camp, sometimes you can get a little distorted with it. But this is what folks usually think of course. This is a coal camp. This is much later in the century than I would like, but it's all I had available. This is an actual coal camp. This is a very early coal camp. Most people will look at it and say, oh, that's a logging camp. No, it's not. It is a very early coal camp. The mine is just getting started. These are the common shanties I was talking about. You can see along along the mine's rail line there. And, of course, a little closer view of the shanty much later on. But very early miners, this would be a pretty good deal. Many in Fayette County very early on lived in crates, lean-tos that they put up quickly and so forth. Because drift mines, they're making a profit almost from the initial strike of the pick. They're going to drift into the seam. So you're going to start making money. That timber that's close by is going to be used for the physical plant of the mine. And so miners make do. And these shanties, oftentimes there will be as many as four in one of these shanties, four miners. Well, you get some hot-headed individuals together and they're going to have problems. And many single men in the thick coal field, they often became rather transient. They consistently shantied. They're constantly moving, looking for a better position somewhere else. And so they will shanty up, as they say, with other miners. A lot of times, particularly in reading court cases, I've found that someone is brought in to testify in a murder trial because they shantied with a particular person at some other mine. And in some cases, they shantied with them more than once in three or four different places. Witnesses and defendants testifying in court cases, they almost always made the distinction between a house and a shanty. For instance, testifying at his murder trial, a Virginian, Jesse Briggs, said that the woman he shot had stayed in up at his shanty after she got shot. He didn't say a house. But then he said later on that she was starting to visit at a family's company-built quarters. He mentioned that as a house. They made the distinction. I'm running out of time here. Jesse Briggs, a very interesting case. Black miners, of course, are going to have fewer black females available, particularly in the early days. And so there's more competition for the females. A young woman by the name of Mary Young definitely had a rough reputation. She had cut someone's throat with a straight razor at one point. She had wounded another individual. I was unable to actually define her profession. I'm trying to be kind. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I can tell that she would attach herself to different men. She spent some time in and around rougher areas. But the result of her ways, her behavior, she was attacked with a straight razor and then shot herself. Jesse Briggs is quite in love with Mary Young, so when he finds out that she's laying somewhere barely getting by and may die at any time, he takes her to his shanty and nurses her back to health. When Mary Young improves, her health improves, she starts hanging out at a place close to Dairy Hill, fairly near to Glen Jean there. And Jesse Briggs is quite jealous. So he went to this house. Mary Young is sitting on the bed. A male individual sitting beside of her. Jesse Briggs hangs around the house for a while. And she makes some comments that can be heard throughout the house about him being there. And finally, just in a rage, apparently, although once again in the court transcript, it's very difficult to get at the truth, He simply stepped to the door, opened up with his 38 Ivor Johnson, killed the young man with her, and wounded her. And one of the reasons it's such an interesting case, Jesse Briggs got away. He was pretty slick. He made his way over by the old coke ovens there at Dunloop number 2, got down into Glen Jean, followed the railroad tracks to Thurman, caught a couple of freights, caught a coal drag, made his way all the way back to Virginia, and he was home scot-free. But what might bring him back? His love for Mary Young. And they caught him as soon as he got back. He was actually killed at Moundsville during a fit of temper there. He had been found guilty and designated for the gallows, but his sentence was commuted, which happened rather often. Again, this very early coal camp situation. These are some of this very early saloon. Red Rabbit is a very popular name for saloons, and I don't know why. I haven't been able to figure that out. This is the Red Rabbit at Mount Carbon. There was a famous Red Rabbit in Scarborough. Lots of shootings occurred there. And actually, that's McDowell County, doesn't count. Lots of what they were called gaming rooms in the time period were highly popular. This was in Glen Jean, a little more settled a little earlier than the other places. The saloon at Peril or Summerlee, and the bartender has about as much chance of getting killed as the patrons. Happens quite often. And of course, we think of cowboys clowning around. This is staged, but the fact remains, it demonstrates this culture at the time in many ways. And notice everybody has a pistol. And folks consistently carry the pistol in their hip pocket. That's true on the Western mining frontier. My grandfather used to mention that, and I never made the connection for years. That pattern is true for Fayette County. Newspaper accounts, pardon papers, court decisions consistently refer to the opening of lethal hostilities with the drawing of a pistol from a pocket. And if you look at some of the very early films from Hollywood, 1914, 15, very early ones, one of the first things I noticed was they had the characters pulling a pistol out of their hip pocket. And I went, well, I'll be darned. I never noticed that before. Of course, the process of drawing a weapon from the hip pocket in stressful situations can produce some potentially humorous episodes if they had not been so tragic. 1906, black miners Charles Banner and Willard Dickinson got in a quarrel in Scarborough. Dickinson attempted to draw his pistol from his pocket, but he dropped it in the process. It gets hung up in his clothing. And so his foe, Banner, picked it up and killed Dickinson with his own pistol. You're trying to get the pistol out, you're nervous, obviously. They even shot each other at mine sites over trivial matters, once again. Two mule operators at Dunloop number 2, which again is relatively close to Glen Jean. One mule driver said something to the other one in a playful manner about the mule he was riding. He said, look out. I can't remember the name of the mule. He said, look out, this mule will run away with you. And the other mule driver took offense at it, pulled his pistol out and shot him. He said, I'll show you. They were, and one of the reasons I got into this topic originally because my grandfather was so darn mean. And he would talk about this time period, and I would think it was just my grandfather stretching these things out, but apparently not. He himself killed 4 people in his lifetime and got away with it. So I'm finding that Grandpa wasn't always pulling my leg on these things, but in the coal fields, as in the American West, what develops is what you might call hip pocket ethics. This type of thinking centers on the reality that an adversary may well have a firearm on his person. You may attempt to flee from confrontation, but all that's going to do is give your enemy time to aim and fire. With firearms and a philosophy centered on these hip pocket ethics of bravery and so forth, a lot of Fayette miners would seek amusement in argument-prone activities, such as cards and craps and saloons and so forth. they would harass professional shows that came in the area. It happened in Minden. They started cutting the, one of the shows that was going was a high diving act in 1902. It was considered a show of low class. They considered it low class entertainment. I'm not quite sure what they meant by that, but I have an idea. But and it leads to someone being killed. Another form of popular amusement, and I'm thinking I may have showed this here last time, I'm not sure, focused on violence itself. Miners in the early camps flocked to the highly advertised bull terrier versus wildcat fights. And this is actually from a newspaper at the time. It is exaggerated. Actually, if you read Tams's memoir, he addresses this episode somewhat. But there's still an element of truth here. Whiskey flowed freely, guns galore were in evidence, you can count on that. And all was peaceable until after the contest when the melee commenced. And there were lots of melees. The reporter exaggerates somewhat. Now these, what has happened in American history from the time of Jamestown on is areas will be somewhat violent until that society moves more toward family established society. When, I'm trying to think how to say this, when female, more and more females start coming in, things begin to settle down. Well, this is in that period when that's beginning to happen in around Glen Jean in that area of Fayette County. And, the church, the women of the church get involved and they put an end to these fights. Even Tams himself owned a dog that was involved in these fights. But homicides are common in this frontier era. More than common. Sometimes people were simply in the wrong company. They simply were with the wrong person at the right time or wrong time. The establishment of the famous New River Company, a massive company, dominated Fayette County. That is tied back to Sam Dixon and then Symington McDonald. Well, even McDonald's nephew was killed because he was walking with the wrong person at the wrong time. And someone just simply opened up on him and stray shot killed McDonald's nephew. There is a chorus of violence there. But I don't want to stop without saying women get involved in this big time. So some of those early females in particular, it's males will dominate the demographics on the Fayette Cold Frontier, but women they're going to participate in all this. Females committed homicides against aggressive males as well as against other women. 1903, Florence Cheeks moved from Dunloop Creek to Barrie, and she moved there with her minor husband. She got jealous of a younger woman, Laura Mitchell, who lived with the Cheeks, and some quarreling had begun, and she did the way she performed this murder is the way most of them happened. She waited until Mitchell fell asleep. She walked in with a .38 Ivor Johnson and shot her in the bed and killed her. Also, other females received admiration for their marksmanship in dangerous situations. And one of the most interesting cases I came across was that of Martha Sales. Martha Sales was a black woman in the Big Q coal camp near Quinnamon. And she became concerned about a fellow by the name of Wilson Brown and his threats to kill her. So rather than wait and give Brown the chance to get closer and make good on his promise, Sales acquired a weapon. She saw him coming. She drew a bead on her target. And from about 60 feet away, she shot him through the eye. The local newspaper at the time acknowledged Sales as a great markswoman. They were quite impressed with her marksmanship. And again, as I said, some women such as Mary Young fit easily into the definition of a tough customer. Women that come into the coal fields and make a living by entertaining miners, let me try it that way, they also often attach themselves to men in some fashion, but they run the risk of potentially dangerous alliances with habitually desperate characters who are attracted to the hustle and bustle of the region. A lot of these miners don't figure on staying. They're going to work a while, and then they're going to move on where grass is greener, or in some cases they're birds of passage. They want to make as much as they can and go back home and buy the farm and so forth. But during a criminal court term that had 19 murder cases on the docket in Fayette County, 19, one Luella Jones, who was shannying in Boomer, had offended one of her suitors. Now, it became obvious to me that she had more than one suitor. But one Josh Henderson, who was basically a criminal who had come in from Virginia, and Henderson opened fire and wounded Jones in the shanty where they were living. She turned state's evidence so that he could be sent back to Virginia and actually got protection that way. But unattached females with a history, with a, quote, history, needed to remain aware of the volatility of these rugged characters that they're associating with. October 1905, Molly Gibson, who folks in Fayette County were saying she had lived a, quote, checkered life. And that's as far as I could get with it. But she became careless with her flirtations while she was attending a dance at Claremont, which is right, camp right on New River. Her current lover, which was a minor by the name of Joe Thompson, became aware of her behavior. Thompson entered the festivities, in this case, with a Winchester rifle. Gunned Gibson down right there in the midst of the ballroom and calmly walked away unmolested by either local patrons or authorities. No one bothered him over this. There's scant evidence of what occurred, but it seems, the evidence that's there seems to indicate that the unfortunate woman's public reputation limited any official willingness to chase down Thompson. He gets away, he runs away. Well, they're not going to chase him down. They say, well, she had a bad reputation. I've run out of time here. So I want to qualify all this somewhat. I meant to actually cover three cases, but I think I showed this last time I was here. This is one of my favorite, absolutely favorite shots I've been able to find. And looks like some of my relatives, to be honest, but that's a side point. A lot of academics don't want to admit that. It's one of the first things I said in the seminar when they were complaining about some of the Appalachian studies. I said, some of the other students are complaining about it. I said, well, it sounds like a lot of my relatives, so I don't know. But these, maybe it sounds like me, I don't know. But they they obviously are having a good time. And you work in this kind of setting, you want to have a good time. Okay, let me do one really famous case, and I'll bail out of this. This, of course, is a photograph of Elias Hatfield, and one of the famous Hatfield clan. Elias had been given 12 years in Moundsville for the killing of an individual, and then, excuse me, while he is at Moundsville, in this time period, tuberculosis is quite common. And so when someone has tuberculosis to the level that they are probably going to die, the governor will pardon them and they send them home to die. It's quite common. Happened in Fayette County several times. Governor White, who was under attack for being too lenient on crime, in fact, one New York newspaper said, apparently White's not hanging enough people to satisfy the population. He wasn't hanging any, as far as that goes. But White's under attack. Elias Hatfield is in Moundsville. He has tuberculosis. He looks like he may not make it. The prison physician says, we need to send him home. He's going to die. White questions all this. He says, well, now, what are the guidelines here? And he's convinced by the prison officials, he'll be dead in no time, and finally White relents. He's cautious about it because he's under attack. He's too soft on crime, and he's got plenty of it in a time period. Elias is released, and I'm thinking in April, maybe March, White's been told he'll die. He'll die within a couple of months. Well, by September, Elias isn't dead, and White's wondering, well, how come this guy refuses to die? So he goes to he took this to the prison, the president of the pardons board, and I says, well, it's not infallible. Sometimes, people slip through the system, And apparently that's what's happened here. There is no doubt that White is particularly upset when he finds out that Elias Hatfield, who is working as a guard in Fayette County, chased down over 40 miles a miner who had bailed out of his debt peonage to the company and tried to run away. Elias Hatfield chased him down and brought him back, wounded, I might add. But by now, you know, White is thinking, for heaven's sakes, I thought this guy was supposed to die at any time. Then, of course, Elias Hatfield in 1911, which is 10 years later, will be killed in one of the more famous shootouts in Fayette County, the shootout with the Italian and Boomer, where Elias and Troy Hatfield and the Italian that they are sent there to accost, basically, are all killed in the shootout. Now, having said all this, what we've looked at here is a small element of Fayette County society, the rowdy element. If you go out west, you will find the same thing, and it's that small element. The average miner, the average person, is not going to get caught up in a lot of this. They will sometimes by being in the wrong place at the wrong time, yes. But it is that element of society. One of the things I noticed during the Pittston strike, which is an experience I won't forget, is the miners most likely to move toward altercations of some sort were those who were naturally a little more rowdy. Won't say where I fit in on that. I plead the fifth on it. But and that's what's going on here. The average person's not going to run into a problem. In fact, when a rowdy miner guns down George Dent that I mentioned before, there is a mob that forms in Montgomery at that point to lynch him, of course. It doesn't happen. But the general population will take the law in their own hands whenever it gets outside of these group of rowdies. One of the more famous cases I came across was the black population of the Glen Jean area reacting to the sexual molestation of a young boy in their community. And they had to hide the individual and get him spirited away to Fayetteville to keep him from being killed. So I want to be careful. I don't want to convey that all these miners coming in are all killing each other. It's just that group, that element that are naturally, you know, ruffians by trade. Okay, thank you. I didn't mean to go quite that long. So, and in regard to questions, I'm a person who is not afraid to say I don't know. So if I say I don't know, I just don't know. Yes, ma'am.
How did the Italian immigration population, like in Boomer, play into any of this? Did they come later?
They come, yes and no. They really spring up in Boomer around 1903. Now there are incidents between Italians and some of the native-born miners along Cabin Creek, because I'm sort of getting outside of Fayette County now, in that early period, but. My recollection is, 1905, there's about 755 Italians in and around Boomer. If you'll find about 250 Austrian, Hungarian, they tended to classify anyone from Central Europe as Hungarian, in and around the New River County New River Country operations. Now, but it leads into another issue. When I started looking at this material a few years ago, I expected to find that the major problems would be between Italians and native-born, blacks and native-born, and so forth. What I found, with there are a few exceptions, but they are the exceptions for the most part. Most of the problems are within the groups themselves. It's Italians killing Italians. It's native white killing native white. It's blacks killing blacks, and so forth. Now, again, that's just a generalization. It surprised me. Because I thought there would be a lot of animosity between those folks that would manifest itself in that way. But no. Now, as that area matures much more and they need more and more labor, then you're not only are you going to have that more mature coal camp, but you're also going to have a larger number of immigrants by that point. That sort of makes sense. Yes, ma'am.
In the archives, we end up reading a lot of old newspapers while we're searching for other things and seeing interesting articles. And I remember seeing, probably around 1911, a Fayette County newspaper, an issue that was, you know, right around the first of the year. And the column was focusing on how much death and destruction there had been among the foreign miners. Mm-hmm. And I don't think they intentionally did it, but it you know, struck a sympathetic chord in me because it talked about suicides, accidental deaths that they weren't sure whether they were suicides or not, and the arguments would rise from too much drink, and they attributed it to homesickness, to that particularly around Christmas and New Year's, that the foreigners who were there without family and that kind of thing would get very morose, and I guess the mines weren't open maybe during that time period. They didn't have much to do, and they would drink, and it would lead to either deep depression or to arguments, to fights.
It's really interesting. The suicides I've come across, two or three in particular, have actually been miners who were severely injured. One in Glen Jean, he was carrying caps, shooting caps, and his trousers, they went off, and he's hurt to the point that he simply kills himself. I haven't really looked at suicide. That's an interesting topic, actually.
Yeah, I looked for the article because I saved it at the time because I was doing a class on using newspapers, and I can't find it. So,
well, one of the things I've found about Italian women in this period is they favor shotguns. And I don't know why that is. Not that the others don't turn to a shotgun as well, but I came across several cases where Italian women made use of a shotgun to get rid of a husband that was just too much of a problem. But it's not one of those things that I could really chase down. So I do know they're good shotgun. They're good with shotguns.
Shotguns are weapons of choice in Italy.
Really?
That was the reason. Yes.
What?
Mm-hmm. Weapons of choice in Italy.
That's interesting. What the mafia used to buy. So they bring that from their culture of having. Well, that's great. I've solved that. I don't have to solve that. No, I know. I'll get your name later. I'll just use you. I'll cite you.
I have another question. Sure. This might be slightly off topic, but did the coal industry in the beginning use the river to transport, or was it all railroads?
Well, it depends on what. The Kanawha River was used very early on, you know, looking at Fayette County. The New River, no, that's too much of a problem because of the layout of the river. To actually mine coal on an industrial scale would be extremely difficult. But certainly very early mines, even before the Civil War in this area, made use of the Kanawha River, which was problematic seasonally as well. But yeah, it was. But when you get in the rougher areas where these coal seams are jutting out, you know, in the mountains, you can actually see the seam itself and drift in. Well, most of those rivers are pretty rugged. It's for opening up Fayette County. It is, of course, the CNO coming through, and once the CNO railroad comes through in the 1870s, then it's the transportation network there is there to mine commercially. Is that sort of. Yes, sir.
Does the Dunblane Hotel fit into this time frame? I've heard a lot of stories of going on there.
It certainly. I should have put a photograph of the Dunblane up here. Not for the average miner, for the mine operators. The Dunblane is very important. Yes, and I come across occasional episodes of violence in that area, but nothing. I don't find it, even though it's more famous. Thurman's more famous for being violent and so forth. What I find, it's at places I mentioned, such as Beechwood and Rush Run. In fact, I just have to remember, The only time I have ever come across two individuals walking out into the street, squaring off, drawing weapons, and see who survives, happened not far from Thurman at Rush Run. But there, I found a few shootings in pool rooms in that area and so forth. And the Dunn Glen, of course, that's its heyday. Co-operators make consistent use of the railroad there at Thurman, of course, or at Thurman, traveling to and from, meeting with their investors and so forth. One of the more interesting episodes I came across among co-operators, there was a lot of animosity between Sam Dixon, who started the New River Company, one of the operators I have a great deal of respect for because he knew mining, he knew what he was doing. Between Sam Dixon and Justice Collins. Justice Collins, in reading his papers, say it publicly, may be the most despicable human being I've ever had any awareness of. This guy is a real piece of work. And so what I'm getting at is the co-operators were not above going at each other once in a while, and Sam Dixon threw Justice Collins in the motor pit down at Thurman because they got off the train there and got in an argument over some land sales that were going on. You also find cases of attorneys and federal who get involved in shootouts. But yeah, Thurman is certainly, it's the place, if you don't have cocaine, it's the place to go buy cocaine. You go into the Thurman area and over on the south side, somewhere you can find it. Thurman, of course, is where there's more established businesses at the time. But it is those who are the operators and so forth who realize more the advantage of Thurman than the average miner. Yes, sir?
How did Montgomery compare to Beechwood and Thurman and those as far as rowdiness?
Well, that's an interesting question in that Montgomery itself, of course, that's the only Fayette County sheriff to ever be gunned down was killed in Montgomery by miners. But very early on, Montgomery, of course, is an independent town, and most of the violent activity will occur a little farther up at Mount Carbon and those places, because you have a better established legal and law enforcement infrastructure. Now, I don't want to take that too far. It's still a rowdy place. Montgomery and Mount Hope received the most saloon licenses of any other towns at the time. And I'm thinking Montgomery got 11 in 1906, 5 or 6. I might be off by 2 or 3. Now, this is in a time period, keep in mind, when Kanawha County says, we've got to put a stop to some of this madness. And they stopped issuing liquor licenses on Cabin Creek and other areas, other coal mining areas of Kanawha County. They simply shut it down. And in fact, the years, once again, I'll be within 1 or 2 years, 1904, 1905, when they decided to withdraw all licenses, the last night of the license of one of those places, a miner was killed. Actually, an old Civil War veteran was gunned down. But co-operators tended to believe, especially those like Justice Collins, that it was better to have a saloon, establish it quickly, and then miners could get liquor right along and they're less likely to binge. That was the theory. But it doesn't apply to payday. There was an old European custom that was brought to America, and some folks are aware of it, some are not, called Holy Monday, sometimes referred to as Blue Monday. Now, many of you will think of Blue Monday as Wash Day in Appalachia, and I understand that, but it comes from, usually referred to as Holy Monday. And what it amounted to was workers paid on Saturday. They get drunk and carouse all weekend. Then they don't show up for work on Monday. They lay off. And it was ingrained. It was in the culture. So you didn't fire them for that. And some of that is going on, to date myself somewhat. 1974, when I shifted from New River Company to Pittston Company, I was informed, and I remember at New River, sometimes on Monday after payday, Saturday, especially those three-week paydays, we could barely operate. Because so many folks were laying off, and it's because they'd been drunk all weekend. But I was informed at Pittston we were operating at 25% over strength just to deal with laying off. I mean, it had just gotten built into culture, and drinking was part of that. It's It's the entertainment.
Who ran the saloons? Was it any particular group of people, the coal company, or Italians, or?
Well, no particular group. Many cases, if it's very early on and the operator so desires, they will run the saloon. But in most cases, they are privately operated, even though they may be on company property. You'll find both. You run in the same situation, folks will say, well, where did they get all these guns? Well, they could buy those in a company store. Co-operators wanted to make certain that that liquor was available. Now, oftentimes, co-operator didn't want to deal with the liquor licensing issue. So if he grants rental to an individual who will run a saloon, such as Red Rabbit Scarborough, then he's going to get paid rent. It leads me to another comment that I'm almost... This is one of those things that comes outside the model. What I noticed early on, which I did not expect, I should have, who shows up at all these shootings? Not the coal company guards. If these guards are not dominant in this early period, all that I said about the constable, it's always the constable or someone assigned by the JP who shows up at these shootings. I have yet in this early period to find any case where a coal company hired guard, particularly one of the more famous agencies, showed up at one of these shootings. And so that's, you know, it makes me start thinking, well, wait a minute, what about our model? And I think the difference is, it's before that time period of huge labor struggle when the mine guard system becomes more formalized and there's constant labor troubles getting into the period of paint and cabin creek and wars and so forth. I'm not sure. But I have noticed, again, I have found cases where the more formalized guards of Justice Collins were killed, were gunned down by miners, and the miners got off, got free, because the guard asked for it. So all I'm saying is, I don't know where and when that model we have of that oppressive mine guard system comes into play. It's probably different areas at different times. But there has to be some meaning in this fact that there's never a mine guard that shows up at these saloon shootings and so forth. And when you said that about saloons, and it made me recall that. So. Yes, sir?
On the gentleman that asked about who was running the saloons, Oelis and Troy and
they were, now that there's been some argument that Sam Dixon, again, extremely politically, he's politically powerful, establishes a New River company, that Dixon was involved in a Fayette County whiskey ring and that Oelis and others were just servants of him. I don't know. I don't know, but I've heard that and actually read some articles early on that referred to that. So was he an agent of Sam Dixon? Could be.
Yeah, that the case when it was appealed up to the Supreme Court, that the shooting down in Mingo County, it was appealed up to the Supreme Court. We've actually got the case here at the archives. And his lawyer was Governor Emanuel Willis Wilson.
Oh, yeah.
For that case. Yeah.
It seems like I'd come across that at some point, and I said I neglected to thank the staff when I began here because I came in so late. And but much of what I just said, and much more of the article that's coming out fairly soon on this particular topic, is a result of the help I get from the archival staff in here, and I really appreciate everything, particularly Deborah Basham, who digs out those court cases for me, which has got to be difficult, and she does so with a smile on her face. And prison records. She's very good at finding prison records for me. Is it dinner time? Thank you. Thank you.